Santi en el Prime. Yes. Energía. Yep, you're not getting in my way. Well done. Just lore and one predator token. This is just a boss fight then, huh? And I wish I had managed to finish that one. So close to. The ancient arena is a holy place for the people of Argentunur. Constructed in the earliest days of their history, this coliseum served as a proving ground for trial by combat. Historical records indicate that the Argenta did not yield their own kind. Rather, prisoners and criminals were granted the right to earn their chance at regaining honor through victory at the arena. Those who succeeded were given a place to fight in the front lines of the Sentinel Army, to die in service to Argentunur. This traditional use of the arena has subsided since the assimilation with the Dark Realm. The corrupted priests now allow more violent exchanges, with armed captives pitted against demons for sport. The priests of the Order of Deac continue to hold undisputed power on Argentunur. Spilling the blood of the Argent ascended class will result in the transgressor's punishment. Asylum amongst the Argenta will be denied to any who do not adhere to the rules of engagement. Well, sorry, but I'm the motherfucking dumb guy. Feel like I've been here before, huh?
We found him in the valley, just outside the castle walls. He was badly wounded and wearing this.
Oh.
Guts. Huge guts. Kill them. Must kill them all.
He has fight in him yet.
In spite of his injuries.
Send him to the arena. Let him be judged like the others.
Huh. Interesting. History of the Sentinels, part 4. Ah, another Book of Kings one, huh? In the time of King Novik, as the Argenta secured peace and safety through dimensions across time and space, an outlander came to us. He was not of our world, and spoke an ugly tongue. How he first took step upon our land was unknown. Sentinel scouts had found the outlander bloodied, clawed and near dead, mumbling of impending doom and the forces of darkness. The scent of blood followed him, and the gore that stained his armor seemed not entirely his own. By Argenta law, the stranger would be judged in the Coliseum, where he would be given the chance of all who stray from the path to fight for his freedom. We knew not of the stranger. His mind seemed crippled with rage. He dressed in attire not suited for our lands and carried munition of arcane origin. We watched as his will overcame his injuries, and in the blood arena he proved his worth. The outlander's technique was crude and brutal, but the determination in his charge echoed that of any true-born sentinel. His war cry echoed through the Colosseum, as did the sound of his fury, and the guards cheered his banner. "Riband there!" they shouted, as the beast pushed beyond mortal wounds and certain death. He would be gifted no rank, no title. The survivors in the arena were provided only one reward, the right to earn an honorable death while spreading the blessings of the Makers to those in need. The Outlander's determination was witnessed, his ravings documented, and through the word of the Order the Egg, the kind Maker had him brought before her. She set her minions to learning his tongue, for with his ugly words he spoke of lands unseen, creatures born of fire and a dark place unknown to the Queen and her cast. Yet another opportunity to expand the gift of the Makers to those in need. Well, that was a huge mistake there.
I offer you, O great powerful one, a sign of truce.
Right. Is there of the Sentinels, part 5. On the eve of the Black Star, the Dark Ones came from a world beneath our own, not through ship nor ephemeral vessel, but through the fabric of dimensions. Out of swirling fiery gates came horned beasts from a timeless realm. First one, then many, crashing waves of evil swelled from the obsidian forest of the Argentian overlands. The Alorum clans from the eastern mountains fell first to the Black Horse of Devils, and the city of Telorum was long under the weight of their charge. We Sentinels rose to meet the beasts with spear in hand, the might of the Holy Fleet striking back at the demons, but the dark gates from whence they came gave fear still to even greater hordes. A line of blood was drawn with the fallen of both sides, and the unholy wars began as the time of darkness came upon us. Sounds about right. There's going to be quite a bit of memory, isn't there?
I know of what you have left behind. Go back to it then. Leave this crusade. You cannot save them. They have asked me for this, and so I give it to them. If you let the priest live, then I will return to you what the demons took from you so long ago. You need only turn back, and it will be yours again. All the pain you carry will be gone.
I will never trust your words ever again. Or any demon's words for that matter. History of the Sentinels, Part 6. Unlike enemies of the past, we could not contain the demons emerging from the Dark Realm. Their weaponry was not conjured from machine steel, but from the essence of their very being. A dark magic not known to us in our many conquests. Had we grown overconfident, our victory serving to dull our blade, as we drank in the glory of our expanding empire? Lost, we knew not of how to prevail against this foe. The Maker Ghosts stood perplexed, and our engineers and priests scrambled to find the advantage in battle we so desperately needed. Unknown to the enemy, we were pushed to the brink of defeat, and our gods stood with us as we worked to find the answer. The Order of the Deag were the first to unlock the mystery of these foul creatures. The priests were able to capture several of the beasts, and set about to identify the source of their power. It was then that the essence of the Dark Realm was discovered. Not wholly unlike our own, this power was the life essence that flowed through their twisted form and powered their attacks. It could be harnessed to power our own weapons, giving the Argenta the chance to combat the demons on even footing. The priests believed that with greater knowledge of the essence, we could discover its source and cut it off from the demons to strangle their armies from within. allowing us to regain the advantage we required for victory on the battlefield. The Canmaker gave blessings to Her Majesty and directed the priest to delve deeper into the mysteries of the Scarlet Elixir from the demonic realm, for she sought only to return balance to her universe. Proper assimilation was required, as hell stood beyond her influence. After great effort, the priest discovered more than they had ever hoped for. They learned of the true nature of the demonic energy, and how it could strengthen those skilled enough to harness its power. The energy coursing through the malformed bodies of a relentless enemy could be used to end life or to enhance it. The power to heal, to mend, immortality, knowledge, and enlightened faculties beyond our understanding. With the demon's life force in the skilled hands of the Sentinel Priests, and under the righteous gaze of the Can Maker, our people would not only rise to victory over the unholy horde that clouded our walls, we would move to a higher plateau of existence, ushering in a new era of military science and industrial healing. No Sentinel would grow sick, no Maker would need to suffer the transfiguration that they so feared. All would be risen, none could ever oppose our peaceful ways and threaten our world again. True balance over hell and its regions, over space and time. In this world and all others, we would dictate the order. United with the Makers, we would find peace eternal. Damn, how did that go for you, huh? History of the Sentinels, Part 7. As I sell myself some juice. The Can Maker demanded a tithe of the essence, and driven by her desire, the priests submitted themselves to her will. The order of the Deag took counsel with the king, speaking only of the spoiled lands sure to be found through the cleft in creation, and the opportunity to purge the new invaders from Argent Dunur. We took the war to their cursed land, pressing through the gates of wizardry. There was one among us who seemed to know the true nature of these old demons. It was the Outlander, a stranger who had come to us from places unknown. He who had survived in the front lines far longer than any Sentinel-born prisoner had before. His passion for battle against the vile horde was evident, his lust for their destruction matching her own. To Argent Dunur remained a foreign land to him. His fervor caught the attention of inquisitors of the Sentinel Guard, some whispering of a suspected allegiance he held in secret with the demons. Silencing the critics, King Novik deemed him worthy of selection. The signifiers brought a commission to our king, and it was decided that he be lifted from the common rabble. Though no Arena-born prisoner had ever been granted the honor, the Night Sentinels broke tradition and deemed the Outlander worthy of training. A number of disciplines grumbled and chafed at the barbarian present in their ranks. But in the war with the demons, all opportunities for even the slightest advantage was to be considered, and as they witnessed the stranger's power with their Hallmaster, they found in him an undying, unrelenting compatriot. This man was an outsider, friend to none, and yet rose each time he was thrown to the dirt of the circle. Battered and bruised, his brow stained with blood, he rose with grim determination for the chance to face his enemies in armed combat once again. Time passed as the stranger was instructed in the codified matrices of their order, the ancient lessons of battle and brotherhood taught to all sentinels. He could sense the opportunity before him. Soon, all of hell would feel his wrath once again. Satisfied that he would not be a detriment to their prowess, the Night Sentinels granted him his wish as they ventured through the hell gates with the stranger in tow. They knew no rest, fighting in the unnatural elements and training under the blood moon of night. The stranger suffered exhaustion, wounds and sickness, but asked for no aid and was offered none. Three times the Night Sentinels ventured into the gate and back, and upon every return, the stranger strode more capable than before. His gait locked in step with the march of the Sentinels, a disciplined and now controlled lust for demon blood ever present. The passing of years and innumerous battles with the devils indentured the stranger to Argenta's mightiest warriors, and no longer did they condescend to him as a new blooded conscript, for to them he had become a brother in arms, forged in war, an ally, and a weapon. There's a lot of lore this time, huh? This way, maybe? The tunnel. Yep. There we go. I knew that would open. Okay, so.
This is a hard role to play, but I too have a world to save. Without their souls, there can be no hell energy, and the Argent will cease to flow. I cannot allow this to happen. You will not stand in the way of Erdak's progress. This is how it has always been done. It is not for you to deny us our chance.
Lord. History of the Sentinels, Part 8. Sentinel. Maker. Where am I there? As we were with the beast, the Argenta society grew. Under the watchful eye of the Makers and through the endless power of the Essence, while our generals were consumed with the unholy war, our culture was marked by the beautiful potion the enemy had provided us, the sweet elixir. It brought us immeasurable capacity and empowered us to reach further into dimensions once thought to be beyond our grasp. Under the direction of our Maker gods and the engineering of our high priests, our weapons placed and our war machine stormed. The trunks of the populace drank deeply from the well of energy unveiled by the priests, but we of the Night Sentinels took no part in their abundance. Some among us whispered accusations and warnings against this manner of progress, but they were quelled, as it was not our role to dictate the future of our people, only to defend it. Yeah, sounds about right. Right. Well, this is there just a tiny bit more lore. Well, 3 more pages to be precise. Of the Sentinels, Part 9. Oh. As the Black Star ascended to its zenith, King Novik sat restless on his throne as a howling darkness began to assemble just beyond the mountain rise to the east. The blight came upon us in droves, flooding forth from the Hellgate with merciless fury. They brought with them a monstrous titan, the Dreadnought, a beast to rival the stature and menace of even the mightiest ancestral. The grotesque giant laid waste to all before him, crushing all in his path. This was a total demonic assault, striking at the heart of Argent Unur, as never before. How was it that the behemoth could pass through the demonic gate without warning? We would never know, though the Night Sentinels believed treason was at play. Cut of guard, the Sentinel scrambled late in defiance of the Titan and his horde, and with his coming, the holy city of Taraz Navad prepared for judgment, with the onslaught of the demons masked in the sprawling shadow of the abhorrent fiend. The city shook to its foundation. None were spared save those that fled north. The vile swarm ransacked our temples and palace, burning our towers and feasting on the souls of our clergy. Yet the Night Sentinels rallied and held fast against the demons. Though they were pushed back and corralled at the Blood Arena, as the dark of night descended, their swords remained potent and shred the enemy multitude with abandon. Amidst the unyielding ranks of the Sentinels, when all other apprentices had fallen in battle, stood the Outlander, rip and tear he roared, ferocious in battle. The remaining conscripts of the arena stood in awe as they witnessed the deed. The beast who had once raged within their very cells, now armored alongside the shoulders of his sentinel brethren. He had risen where none other had before, a true-born sentinel fighter, the very best among them. But the swarm fell before their assault. The Titan remained invincible, for none could tame the behemoth alone. In the hours before dawn, as the sentinels weathered the relentless assault, the Outlander held his ground at the foot of the great wall in the northern bend of the castle. Seeing his unending vigor, Samor, Chancellor of the Mother God, hurried the Outlander away under veil of secrecy and, for reason unknown, submitted him to a rite untold. This was heresy, for Samor received no consent from the Khan Maker, nor did he receive her counsel. In the Chapel of Purity, the Outlander submitted himself to the divinity machine. There, Samor Maker, the Seraphim known to us only as the aid of the Mother to the Mother God, blessed the Outlander with fierce speed and power to match his will. It was the method by which this transfusion took place that was most uncertain to us, for we were of the knowledge that the Maker device bestowed onto the Argenta so many generations ago was to be used by the priest only to find the impurity among us. How could it be that the device that was meant to cool the sentinel freed of its contaminants could then be used to purify the Outlander's body and give rise to the one who would lead us into battle henceforth? What rose from the holy coffin on that fateful day was not the impure abomination the Covenant warned us of. The hero within would come to be known only as the Great Slayer, the Time Walker, the Warrior Khan, whose fire sword would blaze forth a path for the just and cut through the demonic horde with a vengeance that only a god king could summon. He rose unbroken by the ritual, his eyes burning with Maker magic. He took the crucible in his hand, and red fire leapt forth from the blade, as only it will when held by a true sentinel warrior king. In our darkest hour, the Slayer had been chosen. Defying tradition, our most sacred laws, and the will of the Great Khan herself, a stranger to our lands, had been blessed with celestial might. Ah, so much to read. At least I can change my voice. The Edgrav remains the most powerful of the Hellpriests among the people of Argent the North, frequently visiting his ancient homeworld to lord over the populace. Arrogant and pompous, Grav calls for blood sport in the arena to entertain the fallen citizens of Sentinel Prime. Since the demonic invasion of Earth began, he has operated on the planet's surface along with his fellow Hellpriests to direct Hell's forces, but after the deaths of the Agnilox and Teag'ranach, he he has fled to the safety of the arena. It was Tiadgrav who facilitated the torment and eventual betrayal of Sentinel Commander Valen. Taking the keys to the Sepulchre of Elements and opening the vault of the sleeping wraiths, the ancient creatures were abducted, transported to hell, and tortured to siphon away their power. He used the heart of Valen's son to animate the Icon of Sin, a titan still spoken of in the legend through Argent Honor. Oh boy. That's a name I've heard before. Hi, Pinky. Literally just waiting there, huh? Fast travel unlocked. Just in case I missed anything. But really, that's all that's left. Gladiator. We got that entry. Oh boy. In the years following the end of the Golden Age, competing factions of Argent and Ur turned against one another. An insidious influence had beset itself upon the Sentinel people, corrupting its once-held sacred traditions. The Colosseum, once a place of honorable combat where prisoners of the Argenta were tested for the right to fight in the front lines of their army, has since become a place of bloodsport. In violation of Sentinel law, the priests have encaged a demon there, a merciless executioner, used to enact judgment of their own decree. The Gladiator, wielding an accursed shield which entombs the tormented soul of his undying master, remains undefeated in battle, infamous for the many lives it has claimed. Yep. Not surprising at all. Not sure why I'm even trying to grab any of that.
Make a fine addition to the front line, stranger.
The demons! They are everywhere. Must kill them all!
Dress his wounds and bring him to us. I want to know more about the others he speaks of.
Yes, Your Grace. If Sentinel Holy Blood is spilled on these grounds, you will lose all sovereignty here.
And I get why. Annoying. Gladiator. When the shield size flash green, the gladiator is about to attack. Okay. Right. he just die? Well, this is pretty easy. That's that. Without his shield, he's more aggressive and has a wide variety of attacks. Already. You are dead. Nothing surprised. You keep telling yourself that.
The portal is ready. We should leave immediately.
Bye. Hell priest eliminated. Blood punch upgraded. Rory kills on heavy demons who will now instantly charge a blood punch. Nice! him in a look. Thumbs down. Yep, sounds about right. It wasn't exactly that much here for obvious reasons. Even the XP. So I need like 20,000 more or something. Hello, to get. I'm level 9 now. Crimson Deluxe skin. Okay. Back to the fortress, back to the fortress. Kinda hoping for some peace and quiet to take a break for a moment for the stream, but I guess that's not happening just yet. I guess I'll just tack this on to the last episode.